in a way. Fissures in NO is very common conditions that you might come across in your practice. Fissures vanakkiyone is a longitudinal slits on the enodermal of the distal anal canal. You see, you're saying, you see, if you see in this picture, this is the fold, okay, and this is what you call the rectum, and this is the anal folds, and this in the NO and dermal and anal junction, these are. So if you see a slit like this, okay, below the dentate line, you see a slit like this, that is up to the mucous membrane. There are like fissure, like in the anorectal anal dermal junction. Okay, so these are very, very painful. Okay, this is a longitudinal slit in the anodermal, in the distant anal canal below the dentate line, is your clone-like fissure in NO. If you remember, in the cold days or seasons, you get something like in your angle of mouth, you get some very painful fissures, like, you know, when in the cold areas. When you open your mouth, it is very painful. Okay? So the lips get cracked. Don't know as a lip crack in the cold areas. So it is almost like same in the anal region. There is a crack because of different regions, and it's very painful. When the stool passes from the anal region, it gets stretched and get painful. So this is known as fissure in NO. Okay. So if you see the pathophysiology, mostly they are always mostly in a 6 o'clock positions, in 90% in male. Okay. Because in 6 o'clock position, because if you see the direction of the stool that comes down, it comes in the anal region and directed towards 6 o'clock position rather than 12 o'clock position or 3 or 9 o'clock. So the pressure goes more on the 6 o'clock position posteriorly. So the fissure is. So the fissure is almost in a posterior at 6 o'clock positions, but very common there is in the male people. Okay, but in the female, because of delivery and weak anteriorly, this fissure is a more common in female in anteriorly in the midline position. That's very rare in the male. Okay, that's why if you see any fissures in male, you will always look in the 6 o'clock person, and if female, you always look in the 12 o'clock persons. Okay, so they are always seen most widely in young adult because of trauma, and the pain is very severe. You know, very severe pain. They can sit on their buttocks, or they sit just protecting the painful area. Even passing the flatus, they get pain. Even standing, laughing, coughing, or passing the stool, even loose stool, they get pain. Okay, and there is, you know, because of the pain, to keep the pain minimized, there is always spasm of the external or internal oblique muscles, external internal sphincter of the anal canal. So that's, if you try to palpate and see the anal region, it's very difficult because there is increased tone of the muscles. That's why, because that will keep that fissures less painful. If it is relaxed, it stretches, then it gets pain, okay? And there is always spasm and contraction of internal sphincter muscles in the fissure of NO area, because of the, they keep, try to keep that tight so that there is less pain. It could be acute, a sudden tear of lower anal skin, and they get spasm, and then due to the constipations or pain and bleeding, especially in delivery time, when the baby is delivered, during that time, if you don't assist the delivery or don't do episiotomy, it might cause the tear of the anal region and causing very painful. Okay, because of painful, they don't want to pass the stool or flatus, so they develop constipations. And especially there is severe pain and the bleeding. So now if you see the bleeding of this fissure, what happens? Because once the stool pass, okay, it stretches the fissure and they bleed. So you see the blood come first and the stool later on. Whereas in hemorrhoids, the stool passes and it roughs the hemorrhoid and they bleed. So the stool comes first and the blood comes later on in hemorrhoids. But in fissures, the stool comes and then the blood comes first and then followed by the stool. That's a typical feature of a bleeding in the fissured anal. In chronic cases, long standing, they are not that very painful or they can tolerate the painful. Right? Okay, so what happens in those cases, then you see a scar and it's painful when you palpate it. And once they get repeated infections, the fibrosis, sometimes abscess formations, and the fistula may be multiple. And the most important thing that we have to see is sentinel pile, that is known as skin tag. In the area of the fissure, just outside of the fissure, you see a skin tag that's coming out. Is it because of the prolapse of the mucus or submucous area of the fissure area? We'll see a small tag of skin. That is known as sentinel piles or skin tag. That means if you see that skin tag in the anal region, you always think of a chronic fissure in the anal. Okay? That's the diagnostic feature of the chronic fissures as a presentation in chronic fissure in anal. If you see, as I told you, the causes, the curvature of the rectum and the sacrum, you see, is posteriorly. That's any hard stool passing down cause tear in an anal valve leading to a posterior tear at 6 o'clock positions. And because the anterior fissures in female due to lack of support in the pelvic floor, because they have got a very wide pelvic floor, so there is no support, so they tear anteriorly. Especially when there is hard stool and you have a strain, then you get fissures. And because of the straining and hard stool, and there is fissure, there is increased in splintering tone to keep that tear in rest, try to keep that hold on. So in those cases, you know, there might be ischemia and trauma, okay? And this might be more rarely in sexual transmitted disease in the homo peoples, okay? And because of straining, there might be hemorrhoids. Because of tuberculosis or Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis, it might cause fissures because of the repeated straining and passing the stool, you might get what we call fissure in the anal. So these are the causes, especially the most common causes are stool and the delivery in the female are the most common causes. And constipation definitely one of the cause of fissure in the anal. What you see is here, there is severe pain, I told you. It's very, very severe pain. That's why they don't pass stool or gases. They keep quiet and don't do anything. They can't sit in the chair or in the hard bed. So they always lie down sideways, okay? And especially the pain is more severe during the defecations. So these people have got mostly chronic constipations because they're stool hard, they can't pass stool, and they are very scared of taking food, less liquid because of they might have what you call constipations. And their bowel habit is irregular. Once there is constipation, they don't want to pass it. Their bowel habit is irregular, and there is a hard stool, and pregnancy might be one of the cause of the clinical features. So passing of fresh blood early during defecation, I told you this is not infection, defecation. So the blood comes first, then it will come second. Okay, that's very important part you have to see. Okay. And as I told you, there is a small tag of tissue at the site of the fissure outside the anal canal. They are known as sentinel tag. Okay, so it's a guard, something that there is a guard outside the anal opening, and that denotes there is fissure in the anal canal. And this might associate with other problem like fistula in anal. So you have to differentiate this fissure in anal with carcinoma anal canal, inflammatory bowel disease, STD, or sexual transmitted diseases, anal chancre, tuberculosis, and proctal GFR gas. It's a painful in the rectal region that might cause, you have to differentiate from the fissure in anal. But the diagnostic feature is to see a fissure in anteriorly or posteriorly, might be any place in the anal canal, in an opening. And the most important is that if you do a PR, rectal examinations, you have to be very, very careful. It's so painful, they might jump or might go in shock, even vestibular attack. So just take your time, just put your put on gloves and put on xylocaine in the anal canal, in an opening, and slightly stretch the both the buttocks and see if it's painful or not. And you can see sometimes a linear line, a fissure going from outside in. If there is a fissure, don't try to do PR. Okay, it's very, very painful. They might jump, as I told you, they might go in vascular shock. So that is very important fissure, that don't jump and do PR in all the patients. Okay, gradually, if you have to do it, you have to do sensitize it properly, or you have to give a local anesthesia or spinal anesthesia or general anesthesia, then you can do PR. Okay, that's very important part you have to understand. You see, the fissures at oneself site in anal bus because of suspecting any other disease, an investigation for Crohn's, tuberculosis, HIV, lymphocamera, venereals, and all Kaposi sarcomas, beta cell lymphomas, squamous cell carcinoma. So these are unusual type of fissures because of the disease process itself. That's why we have to see also that. Otherwise, usually they are usually because of the are passing constipation, hard stool, and delivery. Treatment is very simple. You know, when there is a what you call the constipations, hard stool, they get pain. That's why you have to give laxatives. And bulky stool, give high fiber diet, plenty of fluids, okay, regularly, so they can pass stool easily, so that the fissure which is get stretched during the hard stool may not get stretched, so they might get time to heal. Or you put a seed bath, you ask the patient sit down in a lukewarm water, tolerable, and open the anal opening and close it so that the steam might go inside, and good fluid intakes. You can use xylocaine or lignocaine locally, and the old treatment was to dilate the anal canal, stretch that, what you call the fissure. You know, you stretch it, let it get what you call stretch and tear board, and it get healed by itself. Or sometimes you can do glycotrinitrate ointment. But this is very important, that this is one of the good drugs. It relaxes the muscles, you know, and it helps the healer, the fissure. But you can't use big amount. Just, you know, enough maca or tauco that they're so small of GTN you use, and apply in the fissure area only. No, don't use those in the side or inside. Otherwise, they'll cause constriction of the vessels and cause hypertension. Okay, that's why this is used. And there is also, they use botulinum toxins also. And operation-wise, the old method and simple method is to dilatation of anal dilatations. If you see, in the, as I told you, in the cold days, you get cracked lips. The best treatment is you lot of, you know, hydrophobic gel or Vaseline or creams, you know. The best treatment is that if you once open wide mouth and tear that crack, and it is very painful sometimes, but it starts healing after that. Once you crack, you just open and tear that fissure, it will start healing. The same thing in the anal fissures. What you do under local anesthesia or in especially general anesthesia, you just dilate the anal canal and tear that fissure, and it let it tear and let it bleed. Once it bleed, that means there will be new granule fission and heal up. This is known as Lord's dilatation. Okay, it's the name of a scientist, Lord dilatation. But you have to be very careful, because if you do overdo and stretch more and stretch the muscles, external, internal, external muscles, then it might got incontinence. So you have to do very carefully to do very exact stretching of the anal canal that cures the dilatation, I mean, fissures. Or there are other techniques like posterior division of sphincter, internally, just give a lateral incision of the internal sphincter, that will relax the sphincter, and that might get sometimes good healing. But if you do the sphincter higher in the deeper down, it might cause the sphincter get relaxed and you tear too much, so there will be problem of the less healing and anal leakage. Leakage means the continence will be lost. That is not a lateral sphincterotomy. So internal sphincterotomy and Notras techniques, all these are what you call not very promising sort of treatment, okay? But the new technique is, this is lateral sphincterotomy that I have shown you. But the new technique is that what you can do is, you see this fissure. As I told you, this is only mucous membrane is here. Only some mucous, you can see the submucous floor. So what you can do is you excise under general anesthesia or spinal, you excise the whole of this fissure, okay? So then you open now. So it will be a sort of a triangular defect here, okay, like this. And once you take out the fissure out, so the margins are raw. So now what you do, then take a stitch in the dermal area and suture this dermal area to this end of a triangle. So what will happen? So this goes and this cover this area and give two stitches laterally. So what happens? It will cover that area of raw area and it will not narrow the anal canal. Okay. If you stitch like here, what they have done is stitch here, anal canal like this, it will might cause the narrowing of the, but if you stitch this end and this end, so this and couple of suture sideways, that not narrow the anal canal. So that's what you have to do in anoplasty, okay? So that's what the advancement of the anal fissures suturing. So that's how you treat the fissure of anal. So the most important part, bulky stool, cis bar, and you can use GTN ointment, or you can go anal dilatations, or lateral sphincterotomy, or anal advancement flap. This is how we do deal with the fissure, you know. Now we're coming to fistula. It's more common, you might come across in your lifetime or practice. This is a chronic communicating tract. Fistula means there are two epithelial layers has to be joined. One from inside, from outside, okay? There should be two epithelial areas that should be joined by a tract. So it's a chronic communicating tract lined by granulation tissue running from inner rectal lumen to outside, perianal, perineum, buttock skin, rarely to vagina, okay? So there must be some opening in the anal canal and they open outside. So they are known as fistula in inum. A tract lined by granular tissue connecting perianal skin superficially to anal canal or inner rectum or rectum deeply. So it can be up to the rectum even. And usually occurs in anorectal abscess. I'll come to that point later on. So there must be opening inside in the anal around that dented line and below. But there might be opening above also in the rectum, but unlikely. So they are dealt in different way. But what fistula anal means, a opening inside in the area of dental line or below, and opening outside in the perineum or perineal, perianal region of the buttock. Okay, that's known as fistula in anal. Okay, so there are two openings, one outside or inside. So they are connecting through a tract which is known as fistula in anal. If you remember the anatomy of anal canal, these are all dented lines, okay? These are all dented lines. And in this center of the disc, there is a junction of squamous and coronal epithelium. Okay, squamous and coronal epithelium joint, these are the lines. So these are fold, okay? And you can see this is the levator ani continuing, this is the circular muscle of large bowel continuing as an internal sphincter of the head. And this is the levator ani continuing as an external sphincter of the anal canal, okay? And there is space between internal ring and external ring. Okay, these are space, okay? Okay, so see, these are the hemorrhoid plexus. These are all hemorrhoid plexus where these are all hemorrhoid plexus, blood vessel. When stool comes and hit this area, so this pull down and becomes hemorrhoids. Okay, so you can see this is internal ring, this is external ring. Okay, and if you see in that this what you call tips of Morgagni, okay, these are known tips of Morgagni or dented line. If you see here in the posterior area, there are six to 12 anal glands. You see, these are anal glands. These anal glands open through the mucosa and come in between the external and internal ring. So these are the mucosa, this is a gland, extension of a gland, anal glands comes out there, okay? That's very important to understand now. Okay, so now if you see this is anal verge, okay? This is anal verge, there are a lot of sweat glands, and this is anodrum, okay? This is what you call the hole is anal canal, and this is external sphincter, and this is internal sphincter, and this is intra-sphincter space. There's a dented line and there is a glands, anal glands in the dented line. So this is rectum above, okay? So this you have to understand. And you can see there are a lot of trabeculates of external and internal muscles here. There are a lot of trabeculates, they come like this. So they are connected with this. So this space is a very easily dissectable space, okay? This space is very dissectable space. That's you have to understand. Now, if you understand this anatomy, why this happens? There are two theories. Because cryptogranular theory means the abscess formation in the anal glands, they form the abscess, and these abscess, see, in this gland, as I told you, posterolateral side of the anal canal, there are a lot of 6 to 12 glands. This gland get infected, okay? Once they get infected, so the abscess is formed. Abscess is formed. The abscess is formed, and this abscess trickle down between the two layers of external sphincter, and they travel between them. That's one. If the gland is closed, so the abscess will try to pass through this area and go up the internal sphincter, and they might go any place up. They might go any place up, down, across the external sphincter and come out to the skin. Or this abscess, they might come not through the muscles, just the submucous layer, and come out from here, okay, in this area. So this abscess is formed because of the obstruction of the gland, and they get become abscesses, and they trickle down between the muscle, outside the below the mucous membrane, and they might come down, open in the anal region, or they might go straightway cross the internal sphincter, come to the internal space, and they go up or down, and they might come down piercing the external sphincter, or they might go directly pierce the external sphincter and come out. So the main cause fistula is the obstruction of the anal glands, and once the obstruction, that there the pus is formed, and the pus trickle down in all the direction that it is, if it's more easy to pierce the tissue, and they become the fistulas. Okay, that's a basic principle. This is known as a glandular theory. Almost 90% of conditions are because of that, and there might be other glands. So transsphincteric anal glands between the sphincter muscles, they might then. And sometimes there is pelvic infections. Okay, you can see there. If there is pelvic infections, okay, in the area. So if there is this is a peritoneum fold, and this is levator annuli. So if there is infection in the perineum, pelvic infection, the infection might trickle down from here, and they might go below down, or they might go laterally, or they might come in between and they pierce. So pelvic infection sometimes might mimic as a fistula sometimes, okay? That is very important. So it could be because of tuberculosis, carcinoma, orphan disease, ulcerative colitis, lymphoma, granulomatosis, adenitis, subaortica, or trauma. So fistula might be, but usually what happens in most probably in the constipated patients, when they constipate during passing the stool, a small amount of stool might go in the anal gland, and they lost their toes, and they get infected, and they come there, pus. And this pus always present, they might present inside the anal canal or outside in the perianal region or perineum region. Okay, so these patients might come with abscess in the perianal or perineum region. That we have to see. If somebody comes with the abscess, throbbing pain, severe pain, can't sit down properly, sleep properly, passes through, and they come with a swelling, red, tender, glossy swelling in the perianal or perineum region, always think of fistula inside. Okay, that's the basic pathophysiology of fistula in anal.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
So what was that hidradenitis suppurativa?
It's the infection of the sweat glands.
Okay, sir.
And that we get in the axilla or in the groin or in the perianal region. Okay. Now we see. Thank you. Now I see. I told you. This is the area, anal canal. As I told you, if there is an abscess somewhere here, it opens below the mucosa. Okay. They are known as superficial fistulas. Okay. And you see all these fistulas. below the dented line. Did you get me? You see, this below the dent. Once there is abscess, the anal gland get abscess, as I told you, they cross the external sphincter, internal sphincter, and come out as a trans sphincter. It means it has crossed both the sphincter. This is known as a trans sphincteric fistula. That's the alcohol classification, that's past classifications, is second degree one. The first degree one is from the anal gland, it crosses the internal sphincter, and between the internal sphincteric space, they come down out. They are known as intersphincteric, okay? Between the two sphincter and comes down and opens. This is a past type one, okay? The one is, it crosses both the sphincters, and this is the hysterectal fossa. It comes out transsphincteric. Both the sphincter cross, this type two. The type third one is, as I told you, it starts from the anal canal, anal gland, and crosses the internal sphincter and come to intersphincteric space. They travel up, go up, and pierce the liberator knife and comes down and open in the perianal region. This is a supra-sphincteric because it has gone above the sphincter and crossed the liberator knife and caused the fistula. This is a supra-sphincteric type 3, part type 3 type of fistula. The other one, as I told you, if there is infection above the dental line and they cross the wall of the colon and cross the liberator knife and comes in the pelvis, a perianal region. Now, if you see any perianal opening very near to the anal opening, a centimeter or maximum 2 centimeter circumference, if you see any swelling, they are called the fistula anal. Probably they are fistula anal. But if you see beyond 2 centimeter, they are not fistula and might be higher fistulas. You got a point? That's what you have to understand. The swelling around the anal canal, around 2 centimeter, not more than 2 centimeter, less than 2 centimeter, is a, there might be opening below the dented line, so they are fistula anal. But the one which away from the perineum, 2 centimeter from the anal canal, there might be something else than the fistula anal, like this one. Okay, so now what happens? So when this, the collection there, the pus collection here, so they get swallowed up because this is closed, the anal gland is closed, they can't drain in the anal canal. So what happens? They starts going to lose space and crosses the sphincter or crosses the internal sphincter and come in the, what you call in the internal space, come down in the perianal region or come go up and pierce the liberator ani and come down. There's a supra-sphincteric and this is submucosal type or superficial type. This is, they don't have, they were not considered in the PARC classifications. So these are the basic principle of what you call the fistula anal. So if you see the most common of fistula are the trans-sphincteric, intra-sphincteric, okay? So the most common is intra-sphincteric, that is 70%, trans-sphincteric 25%, supra-sphincteric or supra-levatory is 4%, and extra-sphincteric, this one 1%. These are extra-sphincteric, okay? So these are all classification, past classifications, 1, 2, 3, 4, type 1, 2, 3, 4. So that's very important, you understand. There are so many classifications, but if you don't need to remember all this, this is the basic principle classification you have to understand by PARC. I'm not going to talk about this Golliger's, all these things, okay? Now, one important classification is just a simple fistula, one single fistula. Okay, or because of the starting from the anal gland. Okay, that is simple fistula. But there might be secondary fistula because of other diseases in the perineum or other diseases in the intra-abdominal like tuberculosis or Crohn's disease or diverticular disease. They might also open in the perineum. They are known as secondary fistulas. Sometimes simple fistulas might open in two different places. Okay, they might one fistula, they open on this and one like this, and they might be interconnected, you know, like a horseshoe. Okay, that's why if you see any posteriorly, if you see any fistula, always think of a horseshoe fistula. They might have multiple opening in this case. So it could be simple. It will secondary to other disease in the abdominal cavity, or it might be a complex fistula causing the two or multiple openings in the perianal region. Now you see, a good solid rule, if the external opening lies in anteriorly, okay, this is a midline, okay, this is a midline, and this is anterior, this is posterior. If any opening lies anteriorly, okay, anterior region, they travel straight down as a straight fistula, like a simple fistula. Okay, if you see any above this line, but any swelling, any opening posterior to this, always think of there might be communicating fistula. Suppose this is the opening here. You see, it has good opening here. Okay. It has multiple opening here. If you see multiple opening, that means they have got a horseshoe type of fistulas. The inside opening is single, but outside there might be two openings. So it is very tricky sort of thing. Sometimes this horseshoe fistula, they might open laterally, anteriorly also. Okay, not that anterior, but lateral anteriorly they can open. Okay, so that's what the horseshoe fistulas. So what the good salt says, if any opening posterior to the midline, always think of a horseshoe sort of fistula. They might have other opening other side. Okay, so if the external opening is posterior to the line, the fistula usually curves to the posterior midline to the anal canal. So this is a curved type of thing. So always any fistula posteriorly, you always think of a horseshoe type of fistula. And the Goodshaw law always apply in those cases. Okay, Goodshaw law, there are the short notes, okay? So they will present very commonly more in the male than female, around 40 to 50 years. The most diagnostic complaint they will do is that they will say, sir, I had a swelling in the perianal region near the anal opening, which is swollen up, very, very painful. I can sit down or I can sleep properly or walk. And this swelling brushed by itself, just discharging some pus and some fluidy things and some tinge of blood. Means that obstructed anal gland, which is swollen up, and cross the sphincter and open in the perianal region or perianal region. That means the swelling has come down and in the surface of the perianal region and as swelling in an abscess. And once it bursts by itself, they get relief and they forget it. Okay. So repeated painful swelling in the perianal region with pus discharge is the diagnostic feature of fistula anal. You always ask these questions. How many times you had this problem? There is a swelling in the perianal region, you got a painful perianal swelling, it brushed by itself and drainage of the pus and sometimes blood, and you will get relief and you forget. Again, after some time, might be after weeks or months or even years, you get the same problem and come back. So always think of fistula again. Once they have a very repeated history of painful swelling, which is cured by itself by brushing. Okay, that's very important. So sometimes they might pass pieces or patterns from that opening also, because there is an opening now, inside opening in the dental line area, in the anal canal, anal duct, anal glands, and the other opening outside. If that is very usual sort of things, then the gas might come apart from the anal canal, it might come from the fistula's tract. Sometimes the feces might come, or sometimes, okay? And always ask about the tuberculosis history or perianal disease like Crohn's or diverticular disease, okay? So, chronic disease, diabetic disease, ulcerative colitis, lymphocytic vasculitis, self-anxiety, HIV, and diabetes. These are the conditions where you get pelvic problem, pelvic disease causing the fistulas. When you examine, you see the opening first. Where is the opening? How far it is from the anal verge? And try to locate and what is the discharge sort of things. And always I said the good shallot, there is an opening in the posteriorly. Always see the other opening somewhere in the posterior line. You do PR and just see anal verge in the midline or posteriorly. Usually you see a swelling sort of thing, small swelling sort of things in the posterior anal gland area. You just do proctoscope after a good evacuation of the stool. You might see a opening, a small opening, localize that. And then what you do, you can probe this opening from inside or outside and pass the methylene blue or hydrogen peroxide and see if the fluid comes out in the from inside out or outside in. You can see the track. And if there is no opening inside in the anal canal, then always think of secondary causes of the fistula. There might be some pelvic region like tuberculosis or ulcerative colitis, Crohn's, or HIV or self-anxiety, something like that, that is causing the fistula. If you don't see any swelling, any opening in the anal canal or above the dented line, is always think of a secondary fistula. You know. You see, there are multiple swelling in the perineal area. You can see this is multiple swelling posteriorly, so also the good for law. And you can see this, there is one swelling and just submucous type. This is a good solloid, there's a two opening posteriorly, and you see there is a swelling somewhere here. And you can see this swelling, a lot of swellings over there. That might be heel fistula, okay? So the most important thing is do the fistulogram. If the opening is patent, you pass a thin catheter and push a dye and take an x-ray. You can see the dye coming in the anal canal, or you can see the pulling of the dye between the two external internal muscles, okay? Or you can do endoluminal ultrasound or perineal ultrasound. You can do MRI to see this thing. Then supportive treatment, you have to do all this, CBC, you must see the ESR to exclude tuberculosis, ultrasound of abdominal pelvis to see all the abdominal problems like tuberculosis or Crohn's or other diseases. Or you can sometimes do a whole MRI of the body. You send the possible culture sample and renal function test, okay? The differential diagnosis you have to choose is a perineal sinus, because there is no internal opening. There's only external opening around the perineal, perianal region. Sometimes it might happen. So this is not perineal sinus. So don't force and make the fistula by doing a hard probing in the sinus. If you do very hard, it might open out inside. So it becomes a fistula, okay? Then sometimes in females, the Bartholin abscess, there might be some other pathologies. Then sometimes, you know, in a delivery, they might have a fistula with urethra, okay, or vagina, or there might be pelvic fistulas because of Crohn's disease, tuberculosis, ulcerative colitis, or carcinoma rectum. So these are your differential diagnosis. And treatment is, there's so many treatment in fistula, you know, it's one of the very common problem, and it has a so recurrence, so high recurrence, that there are so many treatment options, okay. Still today, there's so many, treatment still there is high recurrence. So you have to diagnose properly. And the most basic principle of that diagnosis is very important. Then this track is patent because of ganglion tissue, okay, epithelializations. If you don't remove the epithelializations, they are not going to heal, okay. That's why either you remove whole track or remove the ganglion tissue. If there are any infections, you treat the infection first, and you remove a whole tract, okay, and leave that tract and opening to heal by itself. Or you can do a lot of other surgery. But mind it, and keep it in mind, don't damage the sphincter. Because you know, this fistula, they cross it, both the sphincters, external as well as internal sphincter. If you damage it, the patient will be incontinent. Incontinence means when he strains, when he laughs, when he strains, when he cough, they will have a stool or feces or flatus coming out. That will be very damaging and that will curse you for life. Okay, that is very important. But this is the basic principle of the treatment of fistulas. And the surgical treatment, you can just lay open the fistula, remove the gland tissue or the fibrous tissue, leave it open, or you can just excise the fistula and suture it. And there are so many techniques, you know, lift, okay, ligation or interspecific tract, or video-assisted anal fistula ligations. You can close it by plugs or glue or biological agents. You can use the flaps, okay, or rectal mucosa, or laser ablation can be done. But the most important is that if you can't treat properly, if you don't know how to treat, just put the seton. Seton means loose, non-adult thread. You push from the external opening, okay? You pass from the external opening and take out from the internal opening and they tie there, okay? And leave it there. So this thread will react as a foreign body and cause inflammation and dissolve the epithelial granular tissue and gradually it heals. Or what you can do in this case, this seton is tightened every week. You give a seesaw movement and tighten it. So it cut through and it cut through the external opening and gradually it heals out and later on whole tract is cut out and it heals by itself. This is not a seton technique. The best way you can do it, if you can see the internal ring and internal opening and external opening, pass a thread, nylon or simple thread, whatever you want, you pass the thread, tie it, and regularly change that within every week. So that will digest or the epithelial layer and cause what you call the healing of the fistula. So this is the best technique of this fistula healing. Okay, that's all about the fistula. And bye-bye. Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir.
That's all they want, fistula and fissure. Okay, you go through the books. I think SRB book is quite good for this matter. And you